And I'm going to talk about the human brain, of course, and the functions of the human brain, and how this mass of jelly, 1.5 kilograms you can hold in your palm, with 100 billion nerve cells, little wisps of protoplasm firing away, how this activity of these cells can give rise to the mind, aspects of the mind. And some of it we understand, much of it we don't. Much of it is terra incognita. But I'll tell you a little bit about what we have learned, what we have learned in our lab at any rate. Now, many approaches to studying the human brain. One is what we call brain imaging, which is all the rage now. Open any issue of New York Times or Time magazine, you see pretty pictures and you can engage in this voyeuristic neurophrenology, looking at these pictures and enjoying yourself. But that's one approach we do use occasionally. But what we do is actually go back to the 19th century, early 20th century, to the days of golden days of neurology, where there was Charcot, Hewlett Jackson, even Freud was a neurologist in the early part of his life, and Kurt Goldstein, Henry Head, Lord Russell Brain, all these guys. And the name of the game is to look at patients who have sustained a small injury in a small part of the brain, or a small change, a genetic change, often producing a characteristic change in the patient's behavior, one specific function being altered, everything else remaining normal. So what you don't get a global blunting of consciousness. What you get is often a highly selective loss of one function, other functions being preserved, or one function enhanced, other functions being preserved. And that's what we're going to do. And then can you learn something about what that region of the brain is doing and how it talks to other parts of the brain and how the brain works as a whole? So these are the questions we're going to address. And the way I approached this a few years ago, I came across patients who had phantom limbs. And we've studied this extensively. When I was a medical student a long time ago, I used to run into them and be very curious, but didn't do any experiments. Well, I did do one experiment when I was a medical student. I'll tell you about it in a minute. And then I revisited the phantom limb syndrome and studied it extensively, but that's not what I'm going to talk about today. It's been over-publicized, you know, also shown on TED. I'm going to talk about aspects of synesthesia, which I have not talked about anywhere, some new material. Going back to that experiment, which made me curious about phantom limbs, it goes back to a time about 20, 25 years ago, and I was seeing this patient who had an arm removed and a vivid phantom limb. Everybody here knows what a phantom limb is. An arm is removed under general anesthesia. Patient comes out of anesthesia and he says, you're supposed to remove my limb. Why is it still there? He says, it's not still there, look. And it's not there, because he's surprised. And he says, my God, you've removed it. The vivid presence of that missing limb, which is felt by the patient, is called a phantom limb. And this is very common. 98-99% of patients with amputation have a phantom limb. And many of them can move the phantom. Some of them, the phantom is frozen. And we have developed treatments with mirrors to try and cure phantom limb pain with some success. Now, in this particular patient, he said he could move his phantom limb, as indeed many of them can, reach out and grab a cup of coffee, pretend to grab a cup. There's no harm there, of course. As though he's actually going there, grabbing that cup, that empty cup. And we were talking about this, and he was telling me it's a very vivid sensory experience for him, even though he knows intellectually that there's no harm there. He's not stupid. But very vivid sensory impression that the arm is moving, okay? Then on a whim, I said, what if I pull the cup away as he's reaching for it? And then the question is, would his hand, the phantom hand, extend beyond anatomical limits? Beyond, suppose I move it 5 feet away, will his hand move, stretch out 5 feet, like the guy in that movie, you know, the rubber guy? Where should the physical limitations of flesh apply to a phantom, right? So I pulled it away as he was reaching for it, and he said, ouch! I said, what are you talking about? He said, oh, that hurt. I was actually already grabbed it, and you pulled it away. Wrenched it from my phantom finger, and it hurt momentarily. I'm fine now. And I said to myself, what hand? There is no hand there. Clenching on this thing, and then it feels pain because I pulled it away. This got me thinking about vision and its profound role of vision in modulating phantom sensations, and subsequently the discovery of the mirror box of phantom pain. But today I'm going to talk about something quite different, synesthesia, which I've touched on in previous lectures on phantom at TED. But today I'm going to go in depth and talk about two phenomena. First of all, let's review the details of the old form of synesthesia which we studied. Slight tangent here. Is the human brain unique? Reporters always ask me this. Science writers ask me this. Now, in a sense, it's a silly question because every species, by definition, but the Linnaean system of classification is unique. That's how you define a species. So, of course, the human brain is unique. Then what you're trying to ask is there any structure that is uniquely present in human beings which is off scale and not present in any other animal, any structure. And in the Victorian times, the great naturalist, Owen, who discovered dinosaurs, by the way, good credentials, right, Owen, he claimed that human beings did not fall into the natural scheme of things, that we evolved separately and there are special structures in our brains which don't exist in any other animal, in the great apes. The hippocampus minor, for example, is a structure that's unique to the human brain, on the floor of the fourth ventricle, not present in any of the great apes. Now, Huxley, whose arch enemy, came along and he dissected gorillas' brains in his presence at the Royal Institution, venerable institution in London, and showed that there is no such structure, and certainly nothing unique to human brain, in the gorilla brain. The difference in quantity, but not the actual structure. There's no new structure in the human brain. So he argued we evolved from ape-like ancestors. Irony is that Owen was right. Not that there's a hippocampus minor, there's no such thing. But this structure called the angular gyrus in the left hemisphere, in the parietal lobe, an angular gyrus, there's a structure called the IPL, inferior parietal lobule, which is six times bigger in humans than in the great apes. Became progressively bigger in the hominid line until it achieved a six-fold increase in size and split it into two gyri, two babies. One called the angular gyrus in front, another one called the angular gyrus in the back, another one called the supramarginal gyrus in front. Supramarginal gyrus involved in skilled actions, throwing a javelin, shooting a bow and arrow, taking a spoon and putting food in your mouth, combing your hair, any skilled semi-skilled, which humans are very good at. Tool use, the dawn of tool use, marks the beginning of the supramarginal gyrus and its independent functions. Angular gyrus, equally important, is doing all sorts of tiny little structure, doing arithmetic, left-right orientation, reading, writing, metaphor, lots of things, which you wouldn't expect a tiny brain structure to be involved in, but in fact it's involved in that. We'll come back to those structures later in the lecture. Okay, now, what is the topic I'm going to talk about, synesthesia? Just to kind of acquaint you with the standard common type of synesthesia, which is seen in 1 in 50 people, even though people at Galton's time used to think it's 1 in 1,000, 1 in 10,000, some rare freaks, who's interested in them. In fact, 1 in 50 people see it. We've seen this in our lab. So we had two people with synesthesia who came to me in my office at UCSD. Whenever they saw a number or a letter, they see a particular color, tinge with a particular color. Black and white 5 would be red, 6 would be green, 7 would be 8, 9 would be chartreuse, and 1 would be indigo, and so on and so forth. So every number was a particular color. Galton described this around the 60s, 1860s. Charles Darwin's first cousin, and people ignored it completely. Since then, many case studies of, here's a guy with synesthesia, here's a person with synesthesia, but no attempt to do experiments on these people. And I think 100, 150 years later, we and a couple of other groups were the first people to start experimenting systematically on these people. First thing you ask is, why do people see numbers as color? It sounds bizarre. And when you see something bizarre in science, either it's not real, it's bogus, or you're not smart enough to figure it out. There's something important going on here. Kuhnian anomaly going on. Don't brush it under the carpet. It promises to take you in a whole new direction, creating a paradigm shift. Okay. Well, which one is it? First of all, why does it happen? Why does synesthesia happen? It turns out, so we need to know, first of all, is it real? The phenomenon real? Are they making it up? Maybe they're just crazy, right? Secondly, is it a sensory phenomenon? Is it genuine? Are they actually seeing the color? Or is it just making them think of the color? Like when you say Cinderella, you think of pumpkin, you think of chariots, you think of glass slippers, associated with learning. Is it like that, or do they literally see the color? Next question, what are the precise brain mechanisms if you discovered it? So, you found out brain mechanism, you found out everything. Lastly, who the hell cares? You're some geek or nerd who's just found out some circuitry in the brain has changed and these people see colors when they see numbers. So what? I'm going to see its fundamental importance in understanding many human abilities, elusive abilities like creativity and metaphor. We'll get to that in a minute. Okay, let's go through this journey very quickly, given our time limitations. So first of all, another thing I want to mention is these synesthesia phenomenon is 8 times more common among artists, poets, and novelists than the general population. Why would that be? 8 times more common among artists, poets, and novelists. We'll come back to that, okay? You want to prove that it's real. One of the things we found was you can put, one of the students, 5 were red and 6 was, 2 was blue, sorry. 2 was red and 5 was green, something like that. 2 was red, 5 was green, okay? It was fortunate we found two people like this, and then what we did was to simply give them that, like a colorblindness test which you give, DMV gives you, right? Bunch of 5s with 2 scattered in them, or twos with five scattered them, twos with five scattered them. You see, even I find it difficult. They're arranged to form a shape, and you can't tell what the shape is. The twos are forming a shape. Those, maybe one or two synesthetes here who might see it, right? But you just see a bunch of, and then you scrutinize, and then eventually you see that, that what it is that. Now, the synesthete looks at it, and he says, oh, I see an upside-down red triangle, three times as fast as the non-synesthetes. If he's crazy, how come he's better at it than you and me? So clearly, and he says, I see the color on the page popping out, making the triangle conspicuous, so I can see it instantly, it's upside-down red triangle. This shows us that's a real phenomenon, they're not making it up, okay? Now, what about, you can play, you can do interesting, it's not science, you're doing 19th century science here. You don't need any fancy equipment. Find a synesthete, give him something, and then you say you see color on the letter A, blue color, right? Does it stick to the A, does it spill out? Where is the color? Then he takes a spray cane and he paints it. It looks like a spray spreading outside the number. Then I said, what if I put something like an amoeba around it? It blocks the color. Now, these are not the kinds of statements you'd make if you're just imagining the color, right? The very precise perceptual rules apply, where the color gets stopped, blocked by a contour. Now, okay, what's happening in the brain? Ed Hubbard, my graduate student at that time, and I were looking at brain atlases, and we found that a particular region of the brain called the fusiform gyrus in the temporal lobes, tucked away in the medial temporal lobes, fusiform gyrus, that's where the color area V4 is, discovered by Semirizki, where colors are represented. Right next to it is the grapheme area, the visual word form area, as well as the visual letter area, form area, is also there in V4, touching the color area. What is the likelihood? The most common type of synesthesia is number color synesthesia, and these two, and these two regions of activity for number and for color are right next to each other, touching each other, very small. So we see there's some accidental cross-wiring between these two areas in the brain. Therefore, every time he sees a number, it evokes color, corresponding color. There's cross-wiring. Why would there be cross-wiring? Remember I said it runs in families. That gives you the clue. Galton showed it runs in families. The genetic basis. So in the infant brain, in the fetus, everything is connected to everything, crudely speaking. As the child develops, the pruning genes kick in and prune away excess connections between adjacent brain modules, creating the characteristic modular architecture of the adult brain. Specialized region for color, motion, stereo, maybe also for form. And so happens they're right next to each other. Now, if something goes wrong, it mutates. The segregation gene, the pruning gene mutates. You get defective pruning between adjacent brain areas. Therefore, scope for cross-activation. Every time you see a number, you see a color. So that's our theory. And then we went and did brain imaging and proved that we were essentially right. You take synesthetes and do fMR or MEG. Sure, David Bryan has done this. Ed Hubbard has done this. What we found surely is that when you show black and white numbers, in synesthetes, you get color area lighting up. In non-synesthetes, like all of us, most of us, color area does not light up, okay? So it's very crystal clear. Okay, what if you show them, Roman numbers instead of Arabic? I should say Indian. They came from India, not from Arab. Arabs transmitted, but India came from, what if you show Indian numbers or Roman numbers? What if you show them Roman numbers? The answer is when they look at Roman numbers, they don't see any color, even though they say that's a 5, that's a 6, a 7. It's very important. What does it show? It shows it's not the concept, numerical concept, or ordinality, or cardinality that drives the color, but the visual appearance of the grapheme. That's true of the subset of synesthetes we have studied, but it turns out there are two kinds of synesthetes. One is the projective synesthetes we've been lucky to land on the first time we studied this. They're easy to study, very lawful. Associative synesthetes, irresistible urge to think of something. When they see 5, think of red. It's in their mind's eye, but they don't see it on the paper. Unfortunately, we didn't study those people because it's very crazy and complicated. Science is the art of the soluble, and we found that the first two we said were projective synesthetes. They see it on the paper, see it spatially on the letter. We could study them in detail. Okay. Okay, and I want to tell you about blind sight, but I'm not going to do that because of time limits, but okay, I'll tell you anyway. It turns out that, believe it or not, there are colorblind synesthetes. I saw a dean of a medical school from Harvard was colorblind, not monochromatic, but color deficient, I should say. He limited the range of colors you could see in the world because cone deficiency of cone pigments, the common type of colorblindness, okay? Colorblind in the eyes. But he would see colors in numbers which he could not see in the real world with his eyes open. How is that possible? The reason it turns out is that, this is a hunch again, the reason is that his color area in the brain is normal, and the form area is normal, but his retina does not have the pigments required to process color. So you're bypassing the color deficiency, going activating the number node in the brain, which is right next to the color area, which is intact, even though she was, so in other words, she was born colorblind, but that area survived. That's being cross-activated and making her see colors, which she charmingly refers to as Martian colors, which she does not see in the real world, but only sees it with numbers. Is that clear? There's crystal clear evidence that these people are not learning these associations that is present at birth. Okay, next slide. Okay, there's another twist on the same thing, and then we're going to move on to the next section. This is very interesting. If you look at this, you'll see that initially it looks like just blocks, right? But if you squint your eyes, try squinting your eyes, very tight squint, you start seeing words appear, letters appearing, right? How many of you see letters appearing? Raise your hand. Excellent, excellent, good. Keep going. Okay, initially you don't see anything, and then you start saying, "What? I can't see from here, too much." What does it say?
The first
one. What does it say? Can you read?
No sex.
No sex?
Causes bad eyes.
Okay, there you go. Okay, so now what's going on here is that when the synesthete sees it, they say, "Oh, I can't see, I can't read anything, but it's red, green, blue, yellow, chartreuse, indigo. It must say N-O, oh, wow, no sex, bad eyes." They're seeing the colors without reading the letters first, which means that conscious recognition of the letter does not need to occur. It's activating, cross-activating in the fusiform, and later the color is used to intellectually deduce what the grapheme must be, right? Is that clear? Again, it can't be due to associative learning. It's something that's hardwired at birth. Okay, next. Now I'm going to talk about another fascinating phenomenon which you have not heard before. This is, you've got grapheme color synesthesia, which we have more or less figured out, right? You've got another form of synesthesia, what you call interpersonal synesthesia. Okay, now what do I mean by that? I feel your touch. Somebody touches you, I feel that touch. Interpersonal synesthesia. And we predicted this in patients with phantom limbs. We said, what happens in patients with phantom limbs? Before I get there, class of neurons called mirror neurons in the brain. I'm going to talk about mirror sensory neurons in the sensory region of the cortex. When you look at these mirror sensory neurons, sorry. Okay, you go look at the mirror sensory neurons. You go to the post-central gyrus, the strip of cortex going down the middle of the brain. There's a complete map of the body on the surface of the brain called the Penfield map. Every point on the surface of the body has a corresponding point on the map. Pain similarly represented in insular cortex, in anterior cingulate, there are pain neurons, there are touch neurons, so on and so forth. If you go to S2, another map is there, and that map, about 10% of cells, will fire not just if you touch my thumb, but if I watch your thumb being touched. Extraordinary. Somebody's touching his thumb and my neuron is firing. This is not telepathy, it's not some mumbo-jumbo, it's just what's going on in the brain is taking the visual input, doing a virtual reality simulation, and saying, if I were in his shoes, I would be feeling, effectively it's creating a model of your body in my brain, right? So if he touches himself, I feel that touch stroke, the same neuron which responds to my own stroking of my palm fires when his palm is being stroked by somebody. So the neuron is saying, look buddy, same thing is happening in him as would happen if somebody would touch your forearm. Therefore, I empathize with you. Good. Pain, poke me with a needle. Ouch, anterior cingulate fires, insular fires. Poke him with a needle, he says, ouch. But the same neurons are firing here. So I empathize with this pain. I know what it's like to feel, because the same neuron is firing. But I don't shout out and withdraw my hand. So if you poke him with a needle, I don't shout out and withdraw my hand, right? Why not? I got the same neurons firing, why don't I shout and withdraw my hand? The reason is my normal skin is telling me, look, your mirror neurons are firing, empathize. But don't withdraw your hand, that's stupid. He's being hurt, you're not being hurt. Okay, if that's true, my theory is true, if I amputate my arm, then what should be being poked, what should happen? I should literally feel the sensation in my hand because there's no veto signal. Is that clear? Is that clear, right? There's no veto signal from my arm, it's gone. So if a phantom limb patient watches any other human being poked in his hand, he should shout, scream, and move his phantom arm. 100 years of research in phantom limb, nobody had tried that. We went to the naval office here and then had two patients. One patient was sitting in front of me and I said, I'm going to just let's have a conversation. How long have you had this? About 2 years I've had it. Amputation, okay. I just hit myself. He said, ouch. He said, what happened? I said, you hit my hand. That's very odd. I mean, I've seen things like that before, but I didn't correlate it. I mean, that's very odd. Do it again. And I poke with a needle and he said, I feel the poke in my hand. We've seen this in a number of patients now. And we call it mirror touch synesthesia or interpersonal synesthesia because of mirror neurons. We know the neural substrate. Now, the beauty of this is the guy goes home And I said, okay, let's do something. Next time you feel this pain, in your phantom pain, very common, two-thirds of the patients have excruciating pain in the phantom. We developed the mirror technique to treat this, but here you don't even need a mirror. Ask your wife to massage your hand. Watch her, you're gonna feel a phantom massage, right, with the mirror neuron system. What would you do? He calls me the next day all excited. He says, I got painful spasm and I asked my wife to massage. She said I was stupid. She massaged her hand and the pain went away, sir. And I'm gonna do this every time I get a pain spasm, I ask my wife to massage her hand. So therefore what happens is the patient gets a phantom massage, pain goes away. We've been testing this. Next thing is some people congenitally have this problem. Congenitally missing input from the arm or something. Normal people, otherwise completely normal. My student Claudia and I have working on this on a patient, student volunteer, who had congenital intrasensory referral, right? And this patient, this woman, you tickle somebody, she'll start giggling uncontrollably. She feels the tickle in her armpit, start giggling. Intrapersonal galesthesia, we call it. This came out in the journals. Now, interesting. Now, I want to emphasize one point here before I conclude. The subject is sitting here, and she claims that she can feel, if I poke this person, she can feel it. Now, how do I know she's not making it up? There's always a problem in neurology. How do you know she's not making it up? You can do brain imaging, cost you 20 grand, take you 6 months. So all I did was, I hit the other person, volunteer sitting next to me. Not really hit them, but approached them. She does that. Close her eyes, withdraws, withdrawal reflex, blink reflex. Why would she do that if I'm hitting this person? It's very, very hard to fake these things. She was definitely experiencing these sensations. Last point, okay. Group of synesthetes who have calendars. When you ask them to imagine a calendar, when I ask you to imagine a calendar, in front of your eyes, what do you see? You see a smudged image, January, February, a rectangular calendar, January, February, March, April, May, June, July, December, right? Most of you, 90% of you, see a vertical thing, it's very vague, very indistinct. These people will see a hula hoop. About 2% of the population see a hula hoop, January, February, March, April, May, June, July, August, September, October, November, December, January, February, March, April, May, June, July. Where's the hula hoop? I'm looking for, there it is. That's the hula hoop, okay? Now, why do they see this? We don't know why. Some of them will see a U, some of them will see a L shape. How do you know they're making it up? They're not making it up. But what we did was a simple experiment. Again, 100 years, people are trying to figure out if this is a true effect or not, since Galton described it. All you do is you ask a person to read backwards the number. If I ask you to name the months backwards, alternate months, try it. Starting from December, go back alternate months backwards. December? No, backward. I'll leave out one. Okay, December, October, leave out November, October, and then leave out, yeah. Go backwards, leaving 1 month at a time. Okay, I'll tell you the answer. It turns out that it's very hard to do for all of us, leaving out one. You do it algorithmically, it's very difficult. These people visualize the calendar in front of them and read it off. It's like they had a sheet of paper in front of them, printed, so they can read it off, right? So they're reading forward and backward equal speed much faster than anyone over here, proving in one stroke that these people really have a calendar in front of them. Why do they have a calendar? We don't know. But you can do all sorts of things with this. If they move their head to the right, left side of the calendar fades, they can't remember things that occurred on the left side of the calendar at that time of the year. What happened January 5th? You have to let me look at it, otherwise I can't. Oh, yeah, January 5th, you know, is my prom night or something. So this embodied cognition, powerful example of embodied cognition, where the neck muscles are gating the memories that occurred during that period, okay? Finally, you can take the calendar and you ask him to project it on a screen. You think vertical L shape, right? An L shape on the screen. This we're done, the last slide. Okay, take an L shape and put it on the screen and put it behind it, puts these lines, these converging lines. Common visual illusion you see in all textbooks of vision. What happens? The calendar gets distorted. Their internal mental calendar, which they're projecting on this grid, gets distorted just like real lines would. This takes you to the very heart of the great debate in cognitive psychology between imaging, internal imagery, and externally driven, the difference between illusion and reality, the boundary between illusion and reality. With that, I'll conclude all these interesting, fascinating things you can investigate with very simple ideas and equipment. Thank you very much.